A very good morning to you and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting. Our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So our next item of business is consideration of the Council Tax Discount Scotland Amendment No. 2, Order 2023. This instrument makes amendments to the Council Tax Discount Scotland Consolidation and Amendment Order 2003 to update the qualifying benefits listed there. Entitlement to one or more of these qualifying benefits is one condition used to determine whether a resident is disregarded for the purposes of a council tax discount. The order also clarifies how the change in entitlement to disregard because of having an award of universal credit is to be applied to the case of a person currently disregarded on the basis of universal credit. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provision will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. Do members have any comments on the instrument? So I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument? Okay, thank you. Moving on to our next agenda item, an evidence session to inform our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. The inquiry is looking into how the Scottish Government is working with local authorities, employers and other partners at a local level to tackle child poverty through improving employability. So since summer 2022, the committee has gathered information from local employability partnerships, taken part in a focus group, undertaken visits to North Ayrshire and the Western Isles, and run a call for views. Some clear themes have emerged from this work, and we will explore these in a series of evidence sessions over the coming weeks and in September. So the first theme we are going to look into is the availability of affordable and flexible childcare. Today we will focus on the provisions of affordable and flexible childcare for parents and policies relating to these issues. I want to welcome to the meeting to today's panel Graeme McAllister, Chief Executive of Scottish Child Minding Association, and Matthew Sweeney, Policy Manager for Children and Young People, Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, COSLA, who are joining us in the room, and Irene O'Dane, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Out-of-School Care Network, and Jonathan Broadbury, Director of Policy and Communications, National Day Nurseries Association, who are actually joining us all remotely. And a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So virtual witnesses and members, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Virtual witnesses, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can also indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question as well. Don't feel you have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, that's okay as well. We have a lot to cover this morning, so I would ask everyone to keep questions, answers and any follow-up questions tight. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question, and members online should use the chat box or WhatsApp. So I'm going to invite members to ask questions in turn, as agreed in our pre-brief. So the first theme that we've got at the moment is the impact of funded hours. And if I could bring Paul in.
Thank you very much, Convener. And good morning to the panel. We are keen to, I suppose, begin with quite a broad question, looking at the impact of 1140 hours. And I suppose, what are the key lessons already from the expansion? Obviously, there's going to be a further report or a full report in summer of 24. But I suppose we're keen to get a sense of what lessons have been learned thus far. So I wonder, Convener, if I may start with Matthew Sweeney, just on that broad point.
Sorry. Yeah, thank you for the question. Absolutely. So I think there's a number of things that we can already point to about the success of the 1140 hours expansion. As Paul Kane said, there's a further report coming, but I think we've already got some really good evidence in terms of the increasing uptake, which has now increased from 97% to 99%, and also some really high parental satisfaction, both in the quality and in the flexibility of the offers that have been provided. So I think there's some really strong evidence that's come through so far. I think in terms of what the lessons are that have come from it so far, I think that there was a lot that went into the planning for 1140, which was around understanding the need. A lot of consultation went on in every local authority to understand the needs of parents, what that looked like. That then informed models that have come on, and there's that process through the funding follows the child model to make sure there's that parental lead. And I think that's something we need to think about in any expansion. I think we had the time, capacity and resource. I think that was really important about that was worked out early on, and there was time to grow and expand to make sure that the capacity was there, meets what was going to be the increased demand. And then lastly, I think the importance of partnership working, not just I think between Scottish Government and local government, but I also think the increasing and sort of ongoing work I think there still is around the work between local councils and their partner providers locally.
Paul, do you want to come back in? Thanks.
You know, I just wonder if any of the other panellists might want to give a broad comment on the key principles. Then I'll ask particularly on employability, if that's okay, Convener.
Yep. Graham, would you like to come in?
Okay, thank you. I mean, firstly, I'd like to say, as an organisation, we're really supportive of ELC policy, particularly the intent to close the attainment gap and obviously deliver funded childcare to families. However, we have some very serious concerns about the manner in which the expansion was implemented. There have been a series of unintended consequences. During the 6 years of ELC expansion, the child mining workforce has declined by 34%. In real terms, there's been a loss of 1,926 child mining businesses and over 11,000 child mining places for families. We undertake an annual audit for the Scottish Government, looking at where local authorities are in terms of including childminders in ELC delivery. And last year, with our latest workforce analysis, we actually projected that those trends are set to almost double by July 2026 unless we take urgent action. And that has really serious implications for children, families, communities, parental choice, but also for the Scottish Government's programme for government commitments to extend the ELC down to one-year-olds and to develop a new system of school-aged childcare. The reality is that if providers continue to go under at the current rate, we may not have the providers to deliver those policy ambitions.
Do you want to come back in, Paul?
Yeah, I wonder if I can. I mean, that was very helpful. We're particularly interested in terms of employability and the extent to which 1140 hours has taken people back into the workplace and into the workforce. Obviously, we have some interim data in terms of people, particularly women, going back to work, so particularly mothers. Looking at some of the tables that we've been provided with, there is a bit of a sense that there is something of a drop-off when a child turns three of people in the workforce. But also, I think what we're seeing is a slight increase in people maybe going part-time to actually changing their working patterns to accommodate the childcare offer rather than perhaps the other way round. I mean, has there been any analysis done by any of the panellists at the moment ahead of that summer 2024 report to look at actually what has the impact been in terms of 3- and 4-year-olds?
Thanks, Paul. I believe Jonathan wants to come in. He's indicated he wants to come in.
Thank you. And it was to go back to the original question on the impact. On the follow-up question, we've not done any work on it, but I can speak to that as well. And it's just to sort of echo what Graham said as an organisation and our members, who are predominantly private and voluntary nurseries, that the ambitions of the policy and plans we definitely support, and we know that children accessing high quality provision, it greatly improves their life chances. So there's two aspects to addressing poverty here, which is closing the attainment gap between those from disadvantaged families and their peers, as well as supporting parents into work. I would say that important lessons are that members like ours have a lot of experience in delivering the flexible childcare that families need. The original plans probably didn't involve them enough. So there's estimates that, private voluntary settings would be used for about 20% of the funded places. Recent data shows that it's now over 30%. But the budgets being allocated to these providers are still in that 20-21% region from local authorities. So providers, like our members, are being asked and expected to do more with less of a share of the allocations of budget. So there are important lessons there. I agree with Matthew on the importance of partnership working. That has been crucial to address some of these challenges, but there's big challenges with the workforce that need considering before any further rollout. And in terms of that question on employability, what is crucial is that parents can access places where they need, whether that's close to a work location or within the hours that suit maybe full-time working. There is an important point there that once you spread the 1140 hours over a full working year and not just term time, you're looking at maybe 22 and a half hours a week. So parents are either still having to pay for additional hours outside of the 1140 or make informal arrangements. And the point that Graham was making about childminders is, you know, there's an important question there about blended places and how easy it is for parents going through the system to choose the providers that they want to, and the setup that suits their working life and their needs. So there's an important question there as well.
Okay, thank you. I want to come back in there, Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I'm not sure if you want me to move into theme two as well at this stage.
Yeah, or, happy for you
just
to do that.
To blend the two together, because I think they follow quite naturally. Thank you for that response, Jonathan. I think if I could just perhaps ask one reflection on the 1 and 2-year-olds, and then I'll move on with the convener's indulgence to speak about expansion. But we know that uptake for 1 and 2-year-olds, who are the most vulnerable 1 and 2-year-olds very often in our communities, is actually only at 52%. Obviously, that's, I think, a concerning figure given the determination to try and support people back into work in our communities. So I wonder if there's any reflection on where that 52% figure has come from, why uptake has been low, and what, and I suppose I'm looking to Matthew Sweeney on this, what are councils doing in terms of trying to encourage parents to take that offer up?
So thank you for the question. I think it's a really important one. So I think the first thing to say is there's always an element, I think, of any targeted offer where there's going to be that challenge to make sure that you can get to the right people in the right time. But I think the particular challenge we faced around the 2-year-old offer has been around some of the data sharing issues, which can be incredibly complex. It's something that's been worked on between ourselves, the Scottish Government and the UK Government for some time. But essentially, councils don't have access to the exact people who are eligible for the 2-year-old offer. Now, that is hopefully now in the process of being sorted. There's been legislation that's gone through the UK Parliament, which will hopefully enable that data sharing gateway to exist. And hopefully, I think at that stage, we'll start to be able to provide sort of much more obviously targeted ones that you know the sort of location, and that will make sure that we can access it. I suppose there have been a number of approaches that have been taken by councils about what they can do. There's been work between themselves and health visitors and some of those pathways. Similarly, there's been some interesting work. I know of one council who sort of had a pop-up shop in one of their local shopping centres to try and just get out in the community and do some of these things. But it can be quite challenging to do when you don't have that sort of full data picture at the end of the day. But I think hopefully we're making progress there now.
Okay, thank you. And I suppose, Convener, that leads me... Oh, I don't know if Mr McAllister wants to come in.
Yep.
So I think the reasons are multifactorial. I mean, obviously, data sharing has been a big issue, but also in our experience, there's been quite a lot of stigma around uptake amongst eligible twos. We deliver what are called community childminding services in different parts of the country, and it's an early intervention from family support for families who may be one step away from crisis. And whatever's going on at parental level, it could be addiction, mental health, bereavement, terminal illness, that's been impacting on one-year-olds, and that's been picked up by health visitors or social work. They've recognised attachment disorders. So what we've been trying to do, we've actually got what we call integrated services in Aberdeen and Glasgow, where we're seamlessly linking in the vulnerable families using these services into ELC2. So we're trying to use other feeder routes to actually work on the ground to bring those families in, really just providing them as much support as they can. So again, we're just trying to be creative around that.
Okay, thanks, Graham. Paul?
Thank you, Convener. And before I ask this next section, I should probably draw colleagues' attention to my register of interests as a former education convener in East Renfrewshire Council. Expansion, obviously, is now perhaps where we're looking to. There's obviously been statements made by the new First Minister around 1 and 2 year old expansion. Matthew Sweeney referenced the programme for government. I suppose... keen to understand what the challenges are in that, and in particular, because I think it's something that commands a lot of support across the Parliament. I think very often the challenge in a lot of this is trying to get the flexibility right that will actually allow parents to go back to work. Flexibility brings with it a big cost, because you have to be able to provide that blended model, or indeed provide the physical space to be able to accommodate lots of children and young people. So, again, I'm looking at Matthew Sweeney from the local authority perspective, but I'm keen to hear from other providers as well about what's going to be required in terms of a flexible, you know, expansion to the most flexible options for 1 and 2 year olds. I mean, I've been speaking to local authorities who are saying to me that could mean 10 new buildings, you know, and that brings with it a huge capital cost. 1 and 2 year olds have different needs from 3 and 4 year olds. They have to sleep, for example, if they're in all day. You know, that brings with it a capital cost. So what modelling have you been doing on this?
Thank you. I think it's a really important question, and I agree with a lot of the points you raised about the difference between 3 and 4 year olds and 1 and 2 year olds, and how that might require quite a few differences in terms of how the policy is approached. In terms of modelling, we've not probably been involved in that granular stage yet. We have been having a number of early conversations with Scottish Government officials and some very initial political engagement with the Scottish Government around this. I suppose what seems key to me is really thinking quite closely around the coherence across the childcare offer, considering where we are in terms of the 1140 expansion and the work that went in to go through the hard process of understanding what parents' needs were, understanding what that was going to look like, and then building the capacity locally to meet those demands is quite a long and can be quite a challenging process, I think, as you touched on in your question there. That, I think, then requires us to have a lot of conversations around the timing that this is going to take, around the capacity, and I think crucially around what those resources are going to be. Now, there's an element of that around funding, but also a huge element, I think, around the workforce, and I think colleagues have touched on that and will likely do further on the panel. And lastly, I think that there's a really important question for us to think about where ones and twos fits within the broader sort of offer across the public sector for families. Where does that fit with health service and the intervention that they do, the broader social work services, and touching on some of the points that Graham McAllister raised around the sort of community childminding and sort of community support as well.
If Jonathan wants to come in on that.
Yes, thank you, Convener. And I suppose when we're talking about expansion and Paul's previous question asked about lessons learned, I think there's a really important one here, which is that private and voluntary providers are already doing an amazing amount of work in this space, and childminders as well. You know, they're very experienced about the needs and the facilities of children in this age group. They're already working with your babies and 1 and 2 year olds. They're already delivering those services. And there was a big plea around the initial 1140 expansion, which is look at the infrastructure that already exists in these settings. And unfortunately, that wasn't always fully taken into consideration. We had new nurseries being built next to existing, you know, good provision. We did see some settings actually pushed out of business because of the competition created by new spaces being built. So it's not just a question of how many new nurseries do we need to build, but actually what exists already, how can we develop and work with the private and voluntary providers that are there? You know, they understand the sleep needs of children. They understand how the brain is developing, you know, in these younger children. And they also work with parents on delivering the flexibility where possible around their needs. I think there's a lack of data, and Coram do a study on efficiency of childcare. There's a lack of data amongst local authorities already about provision for under twos, about provision for in rural areas, and provision for children with additional support needs. So there's a big piece of work to understand what provision is already existing there to make sure that any expansion plans doesn't actually damage existing good quality provision. And we saw a big focus on growing the local authority workforce, which was important. It was a big expansion. But again, that happened at the expense of existing settings. We had people lose, you know, pretty much entire staff teams as local authorities recruited to the new places they'd created. And that has a serious impact on the ability for existing settings to deliver places that are already, you know, with them, but also continually improve and develop their staff when, you know, a senior management team might be taken on and employed elsewhere. They've then got to build up that staff, and there's a really high turnover, which is still impacting on private and voluntary providers to this day.
Okay, thanks for that, Jonathan. I'll bring Graham in quickly. I see you've got your hand up. And then follow on, I'll bring Gordon in after that. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a very brief comment to largely echo what Jonathan's been saying. I mean, I think from our point of view, the Scottish Government absolutely deserves credit in a sense. It's been recognised very early on that with ELC for ones, it can't be a simple roll down of the existing offer from 3 to 4s. It's got to look very different. It's got to be much more nurturing. Childminding already has so much experience in that area that, I'll be honest, I mean, when my colleague mentioned Capital Villa project, it made me shudder a little because, as Jonathan's mentioned, with our ELC audit, last audit we undertook last year, we found only 4 out of 32 local authorities in Scotland have undertaken impact assessments of their local expansion plans on childminding businesses. Too many have gone down that capital build route without looking at what other provision is already there. So I'd largely echo Jonathan's plea, you know, please look at existing provision. There's extensive experience out there. What we don't want to do is to rush into this and damage other providers that are out there at the moment.
Okay. Thanks, Graham. Gordon, can I bring you in?
Just to expand on where Paul was speaking about earlier, I'm keen to understand whether we've got the focus correct on the policy. If you think about it, we're in a situation where the main aims are to improve children's outcomes, close the poverty-related attainment gap, and support parents into work, study or training. We're also looking at extending the hours to 1 and 2 year olds, and also school age children out with school hours. And also, we've got single parents, we've got all families, we've got working families. So do we have the focus correct? And if not, where should the focus be initially? Matthew, you want to come in first?
Happy to. I suppose, so to say, I think formally COSLA's not had a sort of an official position on this because we're not at that stage in discussions. I suppose what I would come back to is in 1140, we were very clearly from the start had 3 outcomes, which were about the needs of the child and the attainment gap around support for parents. Now, not that specifically about employability, but just whatever can do support them, whether that be training, studying, volunteering. There was that sort of just general support for parents, and then also for a more broader look at family support. I suppose I'm not clear at this stage, and it might just be the stage of policy formation we're at. What is the specific that's being looked at in terms of the you know, in terms of the policy intention around ones and twos or school age childcare? I'd imagine even between those two policies there may be differences in emphasis and focus, and I think that will really determine probably how much we will want to do and how much we'll want to you know, design a policy which is based on some of those things. The investment that came for some of the quality as part of 3 and 4 is because of that focus on you know, improving the attainment gap, supporting children and young people, whereas I think if there's that just broader focus on flexibility and parental employability, that might be quite a different offer that we look at doing. So I think probably I'm not clear in my mind at this stage what the real outcome we're looking for from the further expansion is.
Okay.
Before I go any further in bringing Gordon back in, Irene's indicated that she would like to come in, so if we just give her a second, we'll bring Irene in. Okay, thanks.
Am I on now?
Hi, Irene.
Hi, thank you very much for inviting me to this inquiry this morning. And I'd just like to put in a few points about the expansion of ELC and also these points about quality and the policy focus. And there are things we have to be very careful about here. It's, of course, I think the policy focus is right to focus on the 6 priority groups, those that need childcare the most, and the children who would benefit from good quality childcare the most too. But what happened with the expansion of ELC is that we lost a lot of qualified staff in school-age childcare because they can't compete with the full-time hours and better paying conditions of local authority nurseries, early learning settings. And that has led, and I know this is coming up later, so I'm not going to it too much just now, but it has led to a workforce crisis within our sector. And that has to be dealt with before we expand the sector much more, because we haven't actually got the staff. So that's an issue that we'll come to later, I know. But one of the things we did recently did a survey of parent and carers about access to school-age childcare or not. And basically, one of the parents who said, one of the comments from one of the parents was about, I took on work because I had early learning and childcare, because it was there. And yet now my child is of school age, I don't have any childcare. And the juggling and the stress this is causing me means that, you know, I basically wish I hadn't taken up the job in the first place. But now she needs it and she's going to stay in it. But, you know, there's lots of comments like that from parents in this survey. I know it's been shared with the committee, and I would do read all the comments because they're very, very heartfelt from parents who are desperate for childcare, school-age childcare. And the expansion of ELC has led to this expectation that childcare is going to be there when the children of school age. It's actually quite a lot of them talk about shock of not finding any, or not knowing, or the long waiting lists, and so on. So that's just the comments I wanted to make there. And also, another comment that came through from a parent was, well, I'm a taxpayer and paying, and I can't get childcare, and yet there's free childcare for some families. So we have to be very careful we don't create a divide where the children who go to services that are well subsidised and stigmatised because that's a service for the poor kids, or other parents aren't resentful because some parents are getting free childcare and they're not. So the expansion has to be of benefit to everybody in some way, otherwise that's going to foster these kind of divisions in society. That's just my comments here. Thank you.
Thanks, Irene. I believe Jonathan wants to come in.
Yeah, and it is a very important question in terms of the focus, because there is always a tension between the learning and education part of early learning and childcare and the childcare element that parents need. So I think it is an important question to get to the nub of, because if you are solely focused on providing the places for parents, you end up with a bit of a numbers game. And what gets forgotten is the importance of the child. And as an organisation, we and our members put children at the heart of what we do, because if it's high quality early learning and childcare, we know that the benefits, it's as close as we think we've got to a silver bullet in terms of the impact it has for life chances, in terms of early intervention, so that more expensive and costly interventions later in life can be mitigated or maybe even avoided. And that cuts across all of the priority areas. If you're talking about children with learning difficulties, additional support needs, disabilities, those early interventions in the first 5 years of their life can have huge impacts that last a lifetime. So we come at it from a focus of quality is absolutely essential. So it's important that any plans for expansion, whilst offering the places that parents need, don't undermine the ability of providers, whether that's local authority, whether it's private voluntary settings, whether it's childminders, whether it's out-of-school care, because it's not just about playing. We're talking about children's personal, social, emotional development. We're talking about laying the foundations of learning that, you know, have an impact all the way through primary and secondary education. So if we don't get it right in those first 5 years, when 90% of brain development happens, then there are long-term consequences to that. So that's our plea is, yes, we know that, care for family members is the second or third on the list when it comes to the reasons why people are not in work, and especially for women. And that has been growing recently, according to ONS data. So whilst there's a lot of focus on getting older people back into the workforce, or maybe helping people back who are long-term sick, actually, childcare, whether that's in early years or school age, can be one of those areas that has a big impact on parental employability. But we always come back to that can't be at the cost of the experiences that the children have, and the skills and the qualities that staff working in those sectors deliver.
Okay, thanks, Jonathan. Before I bring Gordon back in, I believe Jeremy wants to come in on a supplementary. Jeremy, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I was really wanting to pick up on the issue of perhaps more rural areas. So when we visited the Western Isles, I think we were told there was only one childminder that covered the whole island. I'm just wondering, as we seek this expansion, how do you think we can not leave those who live in rural island communities behind in regard to that? And are there any good models out there which you can point the committee to?
Graham, if you would like to come in on that.
Yes, I'm very happy to. I mean, it's a subject really close to our heart, in the sense that I've already spoken at length about the declining of the childminding workforce, but the issue has been more pronounced in rural communities, really struggling to recruit childminders, parents having to travel 40, 50 miles to access childcare. You've got additional travel costs. And one of the things we recognised early on is that there are already pronounced inequalities in remote and rural areas. And one of the real risks with the programme for government is that if you then layer on ELC for ones, school-aged childcare, you've got three statutory entitlements. And if some providers already struggling to provide funding entitlement just now for 1140, that gap's going to widen in these communities if they can't access ones and school-aged childcare. So we took a lead about 18 months ago. We convened a national meeting, brought in local authorities, other partners, and we created what's called the Scottish Rural Childminding Partnership. It's really ambitious. It's 15 organisations, and we aim to recruit 100 childminders in remote and rural areas where they're most needed. And we obtained funding from Highlands and Islands Enterprise, South Scotland Enterprise. And what was really important there is that I think at the moment there have been so many pressures on local authorities, on childcare providers during the pandemic, during the cost of living crisis. A lot of people are just focusing on the here and now and thinking, do we have to make cuts? They're not looking ahead at thinking, what workforce do we need? We were absolutely looking ahead thinking, we need to ensure we've got the infrastructure to deliver a programme for government. So that was where there was a really good sort of synergy between ourselves and Highlands and Islands, who recognised, you know, what we're almost trying to do is join the dots between different policy agendas and actually say that, you know, up until now, I think childcare in early years has quite a low value attached to it, but it plays such a huge role in job creation, community and economic development, enables parents to work, enables parents to stay in work. We've got to get this right. So that pilot's going really well. I mean, we're testing what we're calling a supported model of child minor recruitment. We've been running a demographically targeted campaign. As of last week, we now have, I think it's over 40 new businesses established. That's in some areas that have never had a child minder or where employability teams have struggled to recruit before. That's attracted interest from other authorities. We now have a larger pilot with Edinburgh, Glasgow, Dundee, East Renfrewshire testing that model in urban areas. But this is something we really need to put a lot of time and energy into, the investment. And we're working behind the scenes to get this nationally as soon as possible. And certainly, you know, the fact that we're, you know, the feedback we're getting from those rural communities is that what we're doing is providing a lifeline to them. You know, we've got examples of parents who are having to take their children to work with them. It was completely unacceptable. And there are real concerns, as Irene had mentioned, in terms of school-age childcare, child mining. We really run the risk of not having the providers we need. And it is a major concern at this time.
OK, thanks, Graham. I'm going to bring in Gordon now, and then I'll follow up with the next theme and bring in Katie Clark. Thanks.
OK, so there's been a lot of really good points made, and I was particularly struck by the point that Jonathan made about child development and need to get it right for children in the first few years. I wanted to ask, you know, the Scottish Government in wanting to extend ELC has basically said they want a partnership approach. And I'm just wondering if the organisations here today feel that they have they've been happy with the level of involvement they've had in the development of the childcare policy. Start off with Graham.
Okay, thanks.
I think I'd say it's been a mixed experience. The Scottish Government has been very inclusive, but one of the challenges is, which you're always going to have, where you have a national policy that's dependent on local implementation. You know, Scottish Government understandably wants to respect local autonomy, decision-making, accountability. But what you do then get is variation, and that's a problem. We've had some local authorities who've been absolutely supportive, very inclusive of child mining, but we've had others who've been completely the opposite. And that's the problem. You know, you've got real widespread variation around Scotland. Local authorities have also had a conflict of interest. You know, under ELC expansion, they're responsible for overseeing local expansion, but they're also a local service provider in their own rights. Some manage that well, some don't. And that's been one of the problems, that many child minders have been squeezed out. They're still just getting the scraps in terms of the numbers at 1140. You know, regular reports or audits of local authorities not providing parents with equitable, you know, opportunities to access different forms of childcare. So from that point of view, say, on the one hand, it's been positive. You know, Scottish Government's tried to be inclusive as much as possible, but there's also limits, I think, to how much Scottish Government can influence that. You know, we really need local authorities to actually recognise their responsibility. And we're not criticising all, as there are some really good examples of practice, and that's why the Scottish Government has recently commissioned us to develop good practice principles for local authorities working with childminders. We've just completed a draft of that. It's going out for consultation over the summer. But we really need buy-in from local authorities to work with us on this.
OK, thanks, Graham. I know that Irene would like to come in. Invite Irene in, thanks.
I'd just like to say that we work in really good partnership with the school age childcare team at the Scottish Government. And it's a little bit frustrating because we work quite closely with them and we know there's a great deal of work going on behind the scenes. And we kind of operate as like a critical friend of the team, if you like. And one of the things that we've had to pass on to them is that, you know, communications in terms of all of this wonderful work you're doing, no one knows about it. We have to get the information out there about all of, I can't even tell you what the work is because it's not in the public domain. So, you know, But there have been three news releases since last October, and the new First Minister announced the £15 million for the, you know, the pilots and the early adopters services for the expansion of school and childcare. And then just a couple of weeks ago, £4.5 million was announced for improving the school estate to be able to offer school aid childcare and holiday clubs on the school estate. And it's hoped that in coming years, that funding will be used not just for the school estate, but also community venues that provide childcare too. But I would say, and I would like to say that particularly during the pandemic, the whole children and families team that we work with, we all worked very closely together, and I saw people working long hours and very hard, and I would commend the civil service for the work they did. So I just wanted to make that point.
Thank you, Irene. I'm now going to bring in Matthew. Thanks.
Thank you. Just briefly, I think I probably would slightly disagree with some of Graeme McAllister's points around local authorities' conflict of interest. I think actually what drives different models is the needs of parents in individual areas, the statutory duty they have to consult with parents locally and set up models that meet with them. I think that's really important to understand that that is what drives a lot of their decisions and their models, as opposed to sort of some type of competition. I think in terms of partnership working, that's absolutely crucial in terms of how we deliver any childcare offer, considering the range of actors that we need to be involved with it. And I think that's, as I said at the start, I think that's part of the success that we've had of 1140 so far. I'm also quite conscious, I think, around the Scottish Government's stated intention to sort of reset the relationship between the Scottish Government and local government. And some of that, I think, is around making sure that they involve local authorities really early on in policy making. And I think that that will be really important for any further expansion at all. I suppose in some ways there's been somewhat mixed experiences so far. Some of the different policy commitments for expansion are at different stages. I suppose we have had some concerns around decisions that have been taken around funding for some of which that Irene mentioned in terms of the consultation they had with us before they started. Some of them are quite challenging to think about what capital changes you want to make now when you're not sure about the final model that we're going to have in terms of what school-aged childcare means. So that can cause some challenges for local authorities, as well as, you know, bid fund processes that can take a lot of time, be quite challenging as well. So there's a few things around there that I think that, you know, there's probably some things we'd be keen to continue to work on and improve that. But I suppose the last thing to say, I suppose, is that this is something that's come up in discussion between the COSLA Children and Young People spokesperson in the first meeting with the Minister for Children and Young People and keeping the promise. And it'll be something that I think they'll have to return to. And I think a strong area, I think, of agreement around probably the outcome, but really understanding how that's going to work in practice.
Okay, thanks, Matthew. I'm going to bring Jonathan in, and then I don't know if you want to come back in, Gordon. If not, we'll move on to eligibility, and I'll bring in Katie. So, do you want to come in, Jonathan? Thanks.
Yes, thank you. I just want to pick up on a few things that Graeme and Matthew have said. I think we recognised quite early on in the initial expansion of the 1140 offer that partnership working was going to be crucial, both on a national and a local level. So we agreed a series of principles with COSLA initially, and we're delighted that other organisations, other representative bodies across local authorities and within the sector signed up to those. I would agree with Graeme that those relationships vary from local authority to local authority. They're based around, you know, respect, around good communication, and all the principles that you'd expect good partnership working to involve. But I would say that some local authorities get it, some providers get it, others don't, and this is a tricky area of policy because of all the inherent tensions. So partnership working is absolutely vital. So I think we would want to see that redoubled. I would agree with what's been said about Scottish Government working well in partnership with representative organisations like ourselves. But again, like I say, at the local level, sometimes those relationships can break down quite dramatically. We're always looking for solutions because, you know, again, I come back to that point of it should be about, you know, the children's best interests and what works for families. There are lots of areas for potential issues to arise. I'm thinking about cross-border children. I'm thinking about, the issues we've touched on earlier about recruitment of staff from one sector to another. So it is really important going forward into any expansion plans that that partnership approach a lot, I think I would say, more time and investment into that, so that all the hurdles that are going to come up can be dealt with that way.
Okay, thank you very much, Jonathan. I'm now going to bring in Katie Clark. Thank you.
Thank you. The Scottish Government say that they're planning on focusing provision for 1 and 2 year olds on those that need it most. And as you know, the expansion of school age children also is focused, and it's focused on low incomes. What do witnesses think in terms of eligibility criteria and how it impacts on child poverty? What can we do to maximise the impact on child poverty?
Would any of the witnesses like to come in at all on that? Or you want to pose a question to a particular person, Katie?
I think Matthew wants to come in.
Happy to come in. I think back to a question we had earlier around the 2-year-old eligibility provision, I suppose that probably exists, I think, already as a model that's probably understood within the system, and there's sort of a range of aspects to that. There's aspects around income, there's aspects around links to social security, and also there's aspects to sort of, there's a level of discretion, I think, for sort of local authorities to see if there's sort of children that they think would benefit. So I think there's probably something of a model that we could look at there, but I suppose at the same time that needs to make sure we've got that data sharing in place is fundamentally really important to make sure that we can access it, because any time you put eligibility criteria, trying to make sure that you can access and make sure that people are aware of what they're able to access and be entitled to is really important.
Okay. Can I maybe ask if any witnesses have specific proposals in terms of eligibility that they think focuses on tackling and reducing child poverty? I mean, there's obviously advantages and disadvantages in focusing on sort of some of these issues, and particularly on low income. But there's also arguments that I think Irene was putting forward earlier that actually we need to focus, more generally and on all working parents, so both those in work and those not. What do you think those advantages and disadvantages are in terms of which groups we prioritise, or is it better to have a more universal approach?
Thanks, Katie. I'm going to bring Matthew back in.
Thanks. So I think that a really interesting question, I suppose, in terms of the targeted offer, probably something I touched on in my last answer a moment ago about there's always an inherent challenge in terms of, if there's a targeted offer, about making sure that everyone who is eligible is able to access, and making sure they're all aware that happens, I think, with any targeted offer. I suppose in universal, that takes away some of those challenges and some of the issues around stigma. I suppose, though, what our members are probably quite focused on just now is the financial climate that we're working within. And I think local authorities last year before the budget, we had £1 billion worth of pressures. I suppose there's a question about whether, you know, what the scale of there is for this level of investment that would be a universal offer. If we're looking at a universal offer for, you know, all 1 and 2 year olds and a school age childcare offer, that would be particularly expensive. So what would be the trade-off in that cost? And I think when we're having some of those challenges around running some of the existing services, I think that's a really important question to ask about, actually, where would the investment priority be? As you say, there are advantages and disadvantages to all approaches.
So, I mean, given there's probably a limited amount of money, there's decisions that have to be taken. So are witnesses of the view that it's right that the Scottish Government is targeting in the way it is? Do you think they're making the right decisions? Or do you feel that maybe that's something that you would criticise or say needs looked at again?
Come in there, Katie. Thanks. Irene, would you like to come in?
Thank you. I already made the point earlier about the potential for stigma and all had to be developed carefully, but I do think it is the right priority because, you know, certainly in school age childcare, some studies some time ago, but maybe 10 years ago, showed that children from the lowest income who access school age childcare and activities, not just childcare, but, you know, things like sports clubs and other activity sessions like that, this made a huge difference in terms of their attainment and in you know, the basic and also in their social skills. And so for the children who would benefit the most from these services, they're from the lowest income families and less likely to be in employment, so less likely to be using school age childcare. So part of this is about, and I think Jonathan mentioned this already as well, what we're talking about is the needs of the children for their supporting their development and their everyday well-being. There's many children who come into some of the subsidised services over the years. Some children had never been on a trip to the seaside, for example, you know, or visited a museum or went to an art gallery or lent a sport or had the equipment to play sports. So there's lots of benefits to children for themselves. And I think this is the bit where all families who need childcare also want their children to thrive in it. It's not just, you know, a lot of our sector complain that they're treated as if they're just babysitters instead of the qualified professionals that they are. So it really is about ensuring the quality of the service, accessibility of the service. And if it's not accessible to a whole range of families, then there is a danger of, you know, stigmatised provision. There may be, I really like the fact that in primary school we've got universal free school meals in Scotland, because that works. That really will, I'm sure, I don't have the figures, but I'm sure we can find them. I'm sure this increased the take-up amongst children from all backgrounds. And that's important because, you know, when I was a child and got free school meals, you had a different coloured ticket, just to make sure this is the kid who gets, who's getting a free school meal, you know. So that kind of stigmatising, I hope none of this kind of thing happens now. And I know that this is planned to expand for children of secondary school age in the future too. So you can see what I'm trying to say is that there has to be a universal offer while we're targeting the children who need it most. So there has to be improvement for everybody, for everyone to buy in, if you like. Thanks.
Irene, I believe Jonathan would like to come in now.
Yes, thank you, Camilla. I think it is a really interesting question, and I think the fact that that people have struggled to provide definitive answers shows that it is an area, as the policy develops, that's going to need a lot of work, a lot of consultation, a lot of engagement, a lot of thought. So I think, obviously, if you approach it at the very, you know, the highest levels of, you know, conceptually, then universal offers are always better because they, as Irene mentioned, it gets rid of stigma, it increases awareness, so you're not having to go out and find those groups. Everybody knows what they're entitled to, but we have to deal with the reality, as Matthew's highlighted, that the financial position that governments and local authorities and providers are in, there isn't that capacity to deliver a universal offer. It would take a lot of money to make it absolutely universal for all 1 and 2 year olds, as well as what they've got at the moment. I think there are important lessons to learn from the initial expansion. I think initially it was talked about in terms of vulnerable 2 year olds. Now we talk more about eligible 2 year olds, just to, again, reduce that stigma a little bit, because families don't like to necessarily think of themselves as vulnerable, even though agencies might use that as a useful classification. I think there's lessons to be learned from elsewhere as well. So in terms of the groups that have been talked about, ethnic minorities, we know that where there's English as an additional language within families, that can be a barrier. There's cultural elements as well. So, you know, not a stigma necessarily about being eligible for these places, but actually shouldn't, you know, are people expected to look after children and not be seen as handing them over and passing them off onto settings? So I think there's work around, I come back to the importance of the first 5 years, that actually it's not saying that parents are not the primary educators of their children. They absolutely are, and that's where all learning starts, but that there are benefits to children from accessing that high quality early learning and childcare, where there are qualified and experienced professionals working with them. I think we've touched briefly on disability when we're talking about children with additional support needs. So I think that is absolutely a core question to get right, you know, especially post-pandemic. We've seen a lot more issues around speech and language, a lot more issues around personal and social development. So I think there is maybe an underreported and underrepresented issue happening within these young cohorts of children. And again, that might not, you know, come to the fore until they start coming into schools, which is unfortunate. And I come back to Irene's point about not being seen just as childcare, but actually that there is an important amount of work happening there. So I think in answer to the question, children from disadvantaged families absolutely have the most to gain from these policies. And in an area where resources are tight and limited, we appreciate there has to be that focus. It does create barriers, it does create stigma, so it's important to address that. And one interesting thought to throw out there, and it's not to say that this is a solution, but when local authorities were rolling out the 1140 originally, we saw lots of different approaches being tried in different areas. But some areas said we're going to offer it initially to all, you know, parents from lower income backgrounds. They're going to get the full offer as we expand. Other areas said, well, we can offer a halfway house between the 600 and the 1140, and offered 900 hours. So local authorities have looked at, you know, staging different offers. So there's potentially something to look at there that says, if we can't do everything for everyone, what can we look at in terms of, you know, eligibility for the universal offer and what might be deliverable?
Okay, thanks, Jonathan. I know Graeme wants to come in. I'm also conscious of time, so I'll move on next. If you could be as, you know, tight with your time as possible, Graeme, and then I'm going to move on to Miles. Thanks.
That's great. Thanks. I'll try and be concise. In an ideal world, of course, we would favour a universal offer, but realistically where we are, you know, we're pragmatists. We do believe the right thing is to focus on targeted provision. In terms of eligibility criteria, I think the 6-child poverty criteria are well established into Scotland. What we're doing, rather than actually focusing on that, we're currently working more looking at parental employability in the sense and the role of parental employability and actually reducing child poverty in addition to that. And it's what I mentioned earlier, our recruitment work that we started in rural areas, we're now piloting in urban areas. And we've had to be really creative with the source of funding for that, because local authorities don't have flex within their ELC or early year budgets support recruitment. So they brought in employability teams who are using parental employability funding. And it's potentially a really good fit, because the main entry point to child mining is predominantly female, 30 to 39, somebody who's started their own family, makes an informed choice to care for their own children, but needs to earn an income. So you've actually got a really good fit between parental employability funding and child mining, and if that's targeted in areas where there's currently very low provision. So that's kind of where we're getting into that area. But again, it's not without challenge in the sense that it's a national funding stream, but there's also variation in terms of each local authority has its own eligibility criteria. So we're hoping to try and capture learning about in terms of actual criteria around parental employability funding, if that makes sense as well.
Okay, thanks, Graham. Can I bring Miles in? Thanks.
And I wanted to ask a few questions further to the topic around eligibility. I think a number of them have been answered, but I wondered in terms of income thresholds being used, how we can avoid that becoming a disincentive for parents to increase their earnings as well, and if you had any views on that specifically.
Matthew wants to come in, thanks.
Probably not a huge amount to add in, obviously in the interest of time. I suppose there's always that challenge, I think, around any incomes threshold, and we have annual challenges in terms of uprating them and what that means to try and make sure you're looking at the same target group at the end of the day. I suppose there's something for me about the more general work that we're doing around the creation of a fair work economy more broadly, and actually what's the role of employers in some of this as well, not only in the you know, obviously the remuneration they're providing, but also more generally in terms of what support they provide around childcare, a more flexible approach to working hours. Obviously the pandemic has impacted so much of that, so trying to understand what that role could be, I think, is really important to look at that sort of issue.
Yeah, thanks. If no one else has anything on that, I think this goes back to some of the responses which we've received from our call for evidence on this, and it was with regards to their ask for universal free provision. Jonathan, you've touched upon capacity issues and resources, but do you think that is feasible for under threes and school-aged children currently, or would you all be on the same page with regards to wanting to see that targeted support, which I think you've all touched upon?
I believe Graham would like to come in, and then I'll bring in Jonathan. Thanks.
I suppose there's just a small clarification of our position. As I said, we're pragmatic at this point in time. I think it's a right judgment call to actually go with targeted provision. That doesn't mean we should lose sight of trying to get it to universal if we can make that happen. So I think that is important that we try to do that.
Thanks.
Hi, thank you. Thanks for the question, Miles. I would echo what Graham said, is, you know, that what's good for children and good for parental employability is more support with childcare, because that brings down the cost for parents. But that has to be done in a way that is sustainable. And at the moment, the sector is facing a workforce crisis. We've had settings having to close because they haven't been able to recruit the manager that they need. So it's a legal requirement to have that graduate trained manager in place. If you can't find that person, and it comes back to an earlier question on rural pressures as well, that whole setting, however many other qualified staff you have there, that whole setting has to close because it's just not sustainable to stay open. I think the previous expansion saw the local authority workforce grow by over 8,500. There was a similar growth needed in private voluntary settings, but a lot of that recruitment was drawn from existing settings. So, you know, our members had to go back to the drawing board and recruit and train up staff. And time and time again, we heard the story, I train up my staff, and then they're recruited in a local authority setting where they can afford to pay them better because they're better resourced. So I think that addressing the workforce crisis would be absolutely crucial, because if we barrel into delivery and try to offer that universal to everybody everywhere, there's just not the professionals in the sector to deliver it. We're talking about needing a longer term workforce strategy. And really exciting, enthusing kids who are in school now about the possibilities of working in childcare, and that it's not just babysitting. It's not just, you know, if you don't make it academically, then try working in care. Actually, you are making a difference that lasts a lifetime, and that's a big part of our campaign on promoting the sector. And then we also have to look at areas where traditionally, you know, you look at the workforce, it's predominantly female, it's predominantly white. We need to look at how do we draw in people who've maybe not thought about working in this sector before, working with maybe ethnic minority communities, working with more men into childcare, better representation, older people coming back into the childcare workforce. We've done some really good work in Wales through our Childcare Works programme, where we help people who have been long-term unemployed but actually have good life skills. They've raised families, they've been parents, grandparents. We give them the fundamental skills and knowledge to work with children and bring them into the workforce. So we need to look at all options, because with the workforce that exists, it can't be done.
Okay, thanks, Jonathan. Have you got any further questions, Miles?
It's not within this set, but maybe coming later.
Yep, that's fine.
Thanks.
Okay, moving on to theme four, which is childcare workforce. I'm going to invite James, who's online, if you would like to come in. James, thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. I suppose I'm going on to the thorny subject of expansion, recruitment, retention, and the salaries around that. How feasible is it, given the current reported problems, recruitment intention, to expand at this time? And that's what's going to happen, so how can this be addressed? Maybe Matthew first.
Yeah, I think it's a really good question, and I think that a lot of what Jonathan flagged out there around some of those concerns around the workforce as it stands at present, I suppose we've just come through an expansion which required a workforce, and I think there's obviously, there was disruption, I suppose, which caused as part of that. I suppose what it comes to mind, I think, around this is actually we need to think about, and it comes back to that planning, time and resources, what's the pipeline that we can build towards an expansion and make sure that we've got the people coming through colleges, coming through schools, coming through universities who want to be part of the sector, and how do we make sure that it's an attractive place to come to. I think the pressures that exist for private voluntary providers also exist for local authorities in terms of them trying to recruit staff across a number of roles. But I think there's also something to think about the Fair Work agenda in the round as well, because I think that obviously in the adult social care world, we're seeing a lot of focus on what we do to try and increase pay in that area, which absolutely we need for the pressures we're facing there. But what type of an impact does that have on the workforce who would be available for childcare? So just trying to think about all those things within the round. And I suppose it comes back to some of those questions around the investment that may be available for all these different, you know, types of expansion versus some of the questions around the workforce at present. It's a difficult thing to manage all of those things, which could take a huge amount of resource to resolve. So difficult choices probably there in terms of what's sequenced in what way.
Yeah, because one of the issues that's come up. Sorry, was somebody else coming in there? Was that me? Because one of the issues that's coming around, coming out just now, is the fact that there's a feedback here. Is there any particular reason? No, is it just me? Okay. One of the things that's coming out just now is that we're seeing some people saying that the business has been closed down, etc. Other people saying that you can't keep staff if you can't pay them a living wage. So how do we sort of square that circle. If you...
Come in on that, James. Thanks.
I mean, I'd like to go back to Matthew and then ask others if they'd like to come in on the sort of round question.
Happy to. So I think absolutely, and much of what I touched on, I think I'm answering a moment ago. I think it's that challenge fundamentally of the competition that exists. I mean, I think we talk a lot about the competition inside the childcare sector, but it's looking actually what's going on broader in the economy. Obviously, there's been with the broader cost crisis and what that's meant for wages. Obviously, you've seen a number of private businesses, etc., upping wages as well. Whereas the challenge that we have in childcare is the commitment and the funding and the guidance that we have to date has been around the real living wage. So what does that mean in terms of that? The competition perhaps within and without, and it comes back to that point I made before about adult social care. If there's an ambition to go further and faster in adult social care, does that incentivise people more to work in that workforce as opposed to the childcare workforce, and what's the trade-offs that means, and where does the resource come to address some of that?
Yeah, thank you. Does anybody else like to come in?
Sorry, James, I've got a list of people online who want to come in. Irene, and then I'll bring Graham in, and then Jonathan's indicated that he'd like to come in as well. Irene, if you would, you just want to come in, thanks.
Oh, yes, thanks. Field childcare workforce is very part-time and low-paid. And we've shared results of our workforce survey with the committee. But one of the sort of two issues here is the amount of regulation. And so the skilled childcare workforce has to register with the Scottish Social Services Council and obtain the same qualifications as the early learning and childcare workforce. Although it's children, it's older children with different needs, and it's much more about play and leisure rather than the educational element of early years work. So what we are kind of suggesting is, yes, of course, we want to see the living wage at least in the sector. But when you introduce the real living wage for your lowest paid workers, that means others who are more experienced and more senior, their pay has to go up too beyond that. And that is currently unaffordable for most services. And so that would have to be subsidised in some way, because they couldn't then increase the fees to charge to parents. So, you know, parents in the UK pay more for childcare than any other country across Europe. Yet the staff are very low paid. So our staff in skilled childcare earn below the real living wage. And it's part-time hours, so many of them are also accessing universal credit. And if you're on universal credit and you're working part-time hours, you are put under pressure to increase your hours. So that's another reason we're not just losing staff to early learning and childcare. Some are going to go and work in, you know, a big supermarket because they can get a full-time job then and less pressure to increase their hours. So our kind of solution to that, and we're having this discussion in general childcare workforce, but particularly for school-age childcare, is that we really need to widen the range of skills, experience and qualifications that are accepted to register with the Scottish Social Services Council. And for the care inspectorate also has a role in, they kind of judge whether you have the right mix of staff with the right mix of skills. And if you get too many staff that are just on support workers and not enough with relevant experience, that will downgrade the quality of the service. And fair enough, but at the moment, our services and many other childcare services are still reeling from the effects of the pandemic. They've lost staff. I've got experienced managers going back to work on the floor, not just to make up the staff-child ratios, but because they're having to model and teach completely unskilled new staff. And sometimes some of the trainees that they get, they're like, they don't know how to use a toaster or a kettle. You know, there's a lot of basic skills that have to be taught in terms of bringing people into the workforce. So we really do need to have a... If we want to expand all childcare, we need to expand who we bring to work in childcare. And I would also add to points made earlier about it has to be far more diverse, more men in childcare, more people from different cultural backgrounds, and people with disabilities and so on. We have to reflect the whole of our society here.
Okay.
I think that was it.
Thank you.
Can I come back in here, Kavina?
Yeah, absolutely, James.
Yes, thank you. I was just going to ask Irene, it seems that what she's saying for her staff is that the suitability check should still be done, but there should be a lower threshold in some of the other aspects of it for the what she would say is a non-requirement part of her of the job. Would that be right?
Yes.
Right, OK. I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you very much.
Yeah. OK, James, I think Graham wants to come in and then I'll bring in Jonathan.
OK, thank you. I'll try and be concise, but what I'm about to say is quite complex in terms of the interconnected components. The two biggest risks to our workforce, I think, at the moment, the child minor workforce, are the real living wage and duplicative quality assurance. Until recently, there wasn't accurate data in Scotland in terms of the number of child minders that could pay themselves the real living wage. We did a large-scale survey last autumn, which confirmed only 13% of child minders in Scotland can pay themselves the real living wage at the new rate of £10.90. That is appalling. Most child minders come into child mining not because it's a high-income profession, because they want to make a difference. What they find most rewarding is seeing children grow and develop in response to their care. That's why they do the job. The problem we've got is you have complementary but almost competing policy agendas between the Real Living Wage and ELC. We're entirely supportive of increasing the value of pay, but at the moment, the requirements around the Real Living Wage threaten to almost derail ELC expansion. What I mean by that is that because of the funding formula we have in Scotland for ELC, private providers and childminders are not able to pay themselves the real living wage. The rates they receive for delivering ELC are not sustainable. So that makes you question, you know, do we need a form of subsidy around that? But it's also, there's a real risk for childminders because there's a requirement within a national standard. If you want to deliver funded ELC, you have to pay your staff the real living wage. There's almost been a loophole up until now. Because a majority of childminders are sole workers, that's been seen, it doesn't matter that you don't pay yourself real living wage, it's only your assistance. For those who have assistance, it is crippling their businesses. We have larger childminding businesses at risk of collapse at this time in rural areas because the childminders as business owners can't afford to take a wage themselves, but they're having to pay their staff the real living wage. So there's lots of anomalies that we need to work around. But it's also when you layer on, as Irene was saying, you know, around registration, duplicative quality assurance. We've had a situation during the last 6 years of ELC expansion where we've had a massive growth in quality assurance. And we're supportive of quality assurance, but it needs to be proportionate and joined up. And at the moment, it's not. So as an individual childminder, you're actually undergoing three forms of quality assurance for the Care Inspectorate, Education Scotland, local authorities. As a sole provider, I mean, we've now got the majority of our workforce working an extra 4 to 7 hours a week, unpaid in their own time, just to keep on top of the paperwork. That's not sustainable. So we've got to apply those lessons, you know, before we even look at expansion. You know, it's entirely admirable that our First Minister is wanting to accelerate ELC for once, but we need to learn the lessons from 1140 first.
Thanks, Graham. I'm now going to bring in Jonathan, and can I just remind everyone to try and be as concise and succinct as possible? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. I'll take that on board. So I think what I would do is echo what Irene and Graham have said about sustainable rates. In many instances, they are sustainable in name only. We're seeing some local authorities you know, struggling to provide any increase to the rates that they pay providers. And we know a lot of those debates are happening right now. Providers are facing rising costs. Inflation has only just gone below 10%. Wage inflation is probably higher than that, somewhere around 14%. And that is, to pick up on Irene's point, we've got a rising floor with the real living wage, which is great and really important for those low-paid staff. But sustainable rates are creating a glass ceiling. So there's no headroom to pay the managers, the room leaders, the higher qualified staff, the more experienced staff that you absolutely need And as a result, we're seeing staff leave for other sectors. Supermarkets have been mentioned, leave for local authority settings where they can get a better pay. And there is that budget differential between what local authorities will pay to partner providers and the costs that local authorities have to put into their own settings. So children and staff are not getting a fair cut of funding, which is putting that additional pressure on private and voluntary providers. So until you address that, you're not going to address the workforce crisis. I would say there's other evidence in there, and one thing that I just want to highlight is the volume of management, manager and senior practitioners who've gone on to local authorities, and the fact that then we've got a higher proportion in the private and voluntary sector who are practicing under a SSSC, but with conditions on. So they're either having to work towards another qualification whilst they're doing their day job, because those, they've had to replace more experienced staff in the settings. So until you address the funding challenges and the sustainable rates, that's going to be a problem for addressing the workforce crisis.
OK, thanks, Jonathan. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair, and that will follow on to theme five, which is children who need additional support as well. Can I invite Marie?
Thank you, Convener. Just before I move on to my theme, I just want to direct a question to Irene. Irene, in your written submission, you highlight that workers have been lost because of the conditionality regime and universal credit, and you've touched on it a little bit already. Just wondering if you'd like to expand a little bit on it, if you can.
Loving your cap. So, in terms of the working hours of staff in skilled childcare, I haven't got all the information in front of me, but they're very part-time hours often. So sometimes it might be 16 hours or 15 hours a week for a practitioner or a support worker. The average hours for a manager in term time is 30 hours. So if you're paid below the real living wage and on the national minimum wage, basically, it's part of the conditions of receiving universal credit support that you're actively looking to increase your hours. And people who work in school and childcare love their job. So in our survey, one of the things they all say is they love working with the children and seeing them develop over the years. You know, you're maybe working with a child from 4.5 years old until they go to secondary school. That's a long time to be involved in a child's life. But they're being pushed out because of this conditionality with universal credit. And also, even if you really enjoy working in school and childcare, if you have the prospect for you and your family of a much better full-time paid job in early learning and childcare, and you've got the qualifications to do that because the staff do the same qualifications, then you make these decisions on behalf of yourself and your family to go and earn more money and have a more secure job. So it's like all of these forces, if you like, are reducing our workforce, and it's impossible to recruit. And I know that that's part of wider society in terms of staffing shortages everywhere, in care, in social care, in childcare in general, but it's very acute within our services. And quite frankly, it's closing down some services, or it's creating, you know, services who have space to expand, who are allowed to expand in terms of the registration numbers, but they can't because they haven't got enough staff to do so. So this in turn has a knock-on effect on the parents who are desperate for school age childcare. And again, that experience is in this survey I've shared with the committee, that it would take up too much time on that. But basically, certainly universal credit conditions are not good in terms of part-time workers. And once again, mainly women and often single parents themselves. And you know, they're basically workers who are in poverty too. So we have to address this. And I know that's a UK, the universal credit conditions are UK government, they're not within the powers of the Scottish Government. And harking back, if I can mind just adding this in, one of the things about, you know, this threshold for when people get help and then don't get help with free childcare is making sure people know about support for childcare costs if you are on universal credit or if you're a higher earner, much higher earner. There's something called tax-free childcare. And in our survey, although 3/4 did know about either or both of these benefits, a quarter of the parents didn't know about this help with childcare costs. I mean, in my own view, I would rather that funding wasn't used in a complicated system of parents claiming for help, but instead that budget is used to actually fund childcare. And then it makes it much more affordable for everybody. But again, that's not within the Scottish Government's power. This is the UK Government policies. So, bit of added opinion there.
Thanks, Irene. That information is really terrible to hear, but thank you for it. One theme that was quite strong in our call for evidence was about the challenges about access and childcare for children with additional support needs. And although a recent survey of parents found that the availability of suitable early learning and childcare for children with additional support needs had improved, but a third of the parents still had difficulties finding suitable childcare. What can be done to improve this provision further, and what do you feel the challenges are going forward in delivering further expansion? I'll pop it out to Graeme.
Yeah, I mean, I think firstly, what we've found over the last 5-10 years is there's been quite a significant increase in childminders supporting families with additional support needs. I mean, childminding is quite unique in the sense you have continuity of care more or less from birth through to 12 or 16 in case additional support needs. Why parents are increasingly starting to access childminding for additional support needs is because there's smaller adult-to-child ratios, you get more one-on-one care, but conversely that puts financial pressure on childminder's business model, because again, if they're giving more time to that child with complex needs, they're perhaps having to reduce the number of children in their setting. So, there's some child minders where we're finding increasingly specialising in that. We're certainly taking more demands for training. But again, a lot comes back to sort of informing parents about their entitlement. You know, even more generally, when we were talking about ELC, a lot of parents aren't fully informed about what they can actually access. And I think, from our point of view, the point we'd make is that, you know, yes, you can say that, you know, parents are informed, but unless they fully understand, they can't make an informed decision. And that's a problem that we're still finding barriers where local authorities, unfortunately, in some cases, are not actually informing parents of what they can access. There's still a tendency to go for the local authority nursery rather than actually thinking, is there a more suitable setting?
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in on this one? Matthew?
Happy to comment. I'll be very brief. I suppose the thing I would like to put in the context of, I suppose, is the much wider issue or considerations that we have around sort of additional support needs. Over, I think, the past 5-10 years, we've seen a really substantial increase in terms of what that's working and how it works. And I suppose what we've been trying to do through our joint work through the Angela Morgan review was have a look at sort of how provision was working just now. Now, that was primarily focused in the school sense, but obviously has implications across into ELC as well, and through that, on the back of that, the Scottish Government and COSLA now have a joint action plan and a joint implementation group which looks at these issues around additional support needs provision and how we can improve, and ELC members have recently been brought in to bolster that group. And I suppose the last point I'd make, just very briefly again, is that with additional support needs, that can mean very different things depending on each individual child. And I think we need to be really thoughtful about that, and also around what's the range of professionals, not just from the ELC setting itself, but the wider support that comes from across the public sector and how we support that family. Having that coordination is absolutely crucial.
Thanks, Matthew. Can you now hand it back to yourself?
Okay. I believe Jonathan wants to come in quickly on that. So, yeah, I'll bring Jonathan in. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. I'll be very, very quick. It's just a plea to say again that these places are be delivered or deliverable within private and voluntary settings, but it's important to work with the provision that's already there in terms of both identification and responding to children with additional support needs. And again, it comes back to the workforce in terms of number of people to offer additional support and the experience and training that those practitioners have in meeting those needs.
Jonathan. Now going to move on to theme six, which is delivery models, and I'm just going to reach out to each of you and ask, how should the partner provider model develop as funded childcare is due to expand? And I'm going to bring in Matthew first of all on that question. Thanks.
Thank you. I suppose what I think there's a really important thing, and I think it's come up throughout our session, is that parental sort of interest and needs have been so key in 1140, and it seems to me very difficult to think of a world in which that is not part of the future expansions as well. And I suppose in that mind, there's always going to need a mix of provision, and there's always going to need to have that sort of joint working and the ability for partners in the private voluntary sector and child managers to take part. So I suppose there's already work ongoing to look on at the process that we have around partnership just now, both in the review of Funding Follows the Child and the National Standard, which are our sort of guidance around that, and also a review of the rates process. So I think there's work that we're doing just now which there'll be lessons for, but I also think it comes back to some of the difficult questions we've had so far about prioritisation and resources and where they go in terms of if the real call from the sector are around increasing salaries beyond the real living wage as part of that provision and the funding being there to do so, that's got a cost, and what will be the trade-off to be able to provide that. So a really interesting challenge for us to think about in that context.
Okay, thanks Matthew. And if I could bring Guillaume in terms of what is the potential for childminders to provide a funded wraparound service alongside schools?
I think there's tremendous potential in the sense that roughly 50% of the children in childminding settings are of school age, childcare age. You know, something that childminders are already doing, have extensive experience of delivering. And childminding is also a very flexible form of childcare in the sense that childminders are based in their community. When we look at the independent research that's been conducted by Ipsos Mori for Scottish Government and from others, you know, what parents are reporting back to us is that in addition to feeling it more child-led, is the flexibility they get from a childminder they don't get elsewhere. Goes way beyond nursery hours. The childminders that goes above and beyond to provide professional support to them. Parents who use it actually view it as family support. It's not just childcare. And I think in terms of the delivery models, again, to give credit to the Scottish Government, as Matthew has said, there's a lot of work underway. The Scottish Government has engaged us to do some pilot work looking at delivery models in terms of what that might look like for childminding, both for ELC1s and school-aged childcare. I think the main lesson to take from 1140 is that we really do need to recognise the distinct forms of childcare out there and not make a mistake of thinking it's one delivery model and applying it to different providers who are very different in how that would be delivered.
Okay, thanks, Graham. I believe Miles wants to come in with supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I wondered in terms of other models around the world, whether or not we've missed an opportunity to look at, for example, the NHS. And I know people here in my own region in Edinburgh who have not gone back to work because the childcare offering is just not effective for them. Having to cross the city, the time that takes, and actually the lack of flexibility sometimes within NHS shift patterns as well. So is there also something we need to look at in terms of public services and whether or not there's a few outcomes we're trying to achieve here? Firstly, providing this opportunity for childcare, but also getting people to come back to work, and in our public services, the workforce challenges there, and why we haven't looked at maybe the NHS providing that in-house opportunity as well, to actually cater for people's real-life experiences.
I don't know who wants to tackle
that one. No, would you like me to respond?
Sure.
I think we're in what I'd call a creative space where we're looking at all solutions in the sector. Our colleagues from the Care and Learning Alliance, who are not here today, they're currently looking at piloting in the Highlands a sort of a shared model. You know, could you actually deliver adult social care, childcare in a similar setting, given the rural challenges? It was interesting that during COVID, Childminder actually stayed open more than any other form of childcare, and that was due to the small number of children in our settings, reduced risk of infection, and there was very high usage from the NHS professionals because of that flexibility. But a lot comes back to that flexibility they can get in our local community, which they can't get in other areas. But I think, yes, we do need to look, you know, other sectors in terms of how can you creatively respond to demand from those, because, you know, those other professions, you know, it's 7 days a week, 24/7, you know, it's not 9 to 3 in terms of hours of working. To.
Yeah. Does anyone else have anything they want to add?
Irene wants to come in.
Yeah.
Particularly childcare, there are some NHS creche provision on site, but particularly childcare, what we suggest is that places are purchased for parents, like the employer pays in to purchase places in the local services, and that actually helps with the financial viability of local services. And in our survey with parents, a few were NHS consultants, and basically there's a story from one of them where they do have access to skilled childcare a couple of evenings a week, but they're having to use a mixture of, you know, like teenage babysitters and juggling different hours, and they know that this is not the best for their children, and they would prefer for that school-age childcare place to be available for them. But certainly what I would recommend is subsidising places from employers, big employers like the NHS and so on.
Yeah, thank you for that, Irene. I think that's... Carry on.
Could I just make another point, because I don't think it was covered, but there was in terms of delivery models, there was a statement earlier about for many parents the challenge is finding work that fits with school hours, and it says what's the potential for closer integration between school and school aged childcare, for example, provision on school premises or provision managed by the school. Now, I'd like to just point out that there are about maybe 3 or 4 services are actually managed by a school. There are more than half of school-age childcare services are in school premises. However, they are not managed by the school. But to be honest, how do parents know that? Unless the service make it quite clear that there's actually a voluntary management committee or it's a private service and so on. And one of the things our registered school-age childcare service is very nervous about is that if there's this sudden... And there is going to be a lot of investment in the coming years, that's further down the line. But when this happens, are schools going to just take this money and run their own clubs and then displace the existing sector? Now, I can assure you that is not the policy direction that we see so far. And also, I do think head teachers have enough on their shoulders. They have so many responsibilities already, that to then also be the ultimate manager of a school-age childcare service may be a step too far for them. I just wanted to put this point in. Thank you.
Thanks, Irene. That concludes our session. And can I just add, Irene, that we an added welcome to your cat, who's joined us today as part of the evidence session. A welcome addition. Okay, so can I just thank the witnesses for the evidence that they have given here today, and we'll hold a further evidence session on childcare with a focus on the delivery of services in 2 weeks as well. So that concludes our public business today, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. So can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. Thank you all very much. Thank you.